our Father and our God.
Yes, God.
Lord, we thank you for this moment.
Thank you, Father.
That you allowed us one more day.
Yes.
Yesterday is gone and tomorrow is not promised.
Yes.
So right now, this day,
right now.
Lord, we say thank you.
Thank you.
We say thank you.
Thank you.
We say thank you.
Thank you.
We know it's you, Lord.
Yes.
We know it's your grace. We know it's your mercy.
Yes.
We know it's your kindness. Lord, it's all about you.
Yes.
Thank you how you've blessed and how you've kept us.
Yes.
You're so worthy of the praise, and so we just say, thank you, Lord. If we're here right now, blood is running warm in our veins. Oh, thank you, Lord. If we're here right now, we're not in the hospital, but we surely pray for those that are there, Lord, and all the things that are going on. We realize that the world is ever changing, but always you're the same. We lift this church right now, Lord. We lift the pastor and this congregation. As he continues to feed us from on high, your word. And we go out and we be witnesses for you. Lord, we give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise. This day, in the name of Jesus, amen.
Chapter 20, verses 1 through 13. The Israelites, the whole congregation, came into the wilderness of Zin in the first month, and the people stayed in Kadesh. Miriam died there and was buried there. Now there was no water for the congregation, so they gathered together against Moses and against Aaron. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Would that we have died when our kindred died before the Lord. Why have you brought the assembly of the Lord into this wilderness for us and our livestock to die here? Why have you brought us out of Egypt to bring us to this wretched place? It is no place for grain or figs or vines or pomegranates, and there is no water to drink." Then Moses and Aaron went away from the assembly to the entrance of the tent of the meeting. They fell on their faces, and the glory of the Lord appeared to them. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Take the staff and assemble the congregation, you and your brother Aaron, and command the rock before their eyes to yield its water. Thus you shall bring water out of the rock for them. Thus you shall provide drink for the congregation and their livestock." So Moses took the staff from before the Lord, as he had commanded him. Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock, and he said to them, "Listen, you rebels, shall we bring water for you out of this rock?" Then Moses lifted up his hand and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water came out abundantly, and the congregation and their livestock drank. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Because you did not trust in me to show my holiness before the eyes of the Israelites, therefore you should not bring this assembly into the land that I have given them." These are the waters of Meribah, where the people of Israel quarreled with the Lord, and by which he showed his holiness. Let's hit verse 12 again. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Because you did not trust in me to show my holiness before the eyes of the Israelites, therefore you should not bring this assembly into the land that I have given them." I want to use for a subject the cost of not trusting God. The cost of not trusting God. I believe and I imagine that the scariest Christians in the world are the ones who think and the ones who assume that they have the Lord all figured out. Because I'm suspect and I'm suspicious about Christians who can speak unreserved and unconditional about everything about the Lord. And I'm a little bit weary about Christians who have God in a formula and have the Lord locked in a box and think with their limited human understanding that they can tell you everything about the Lord. Because to me, those people probably have never read the Bible. Because over and over in the Bible, we run into and we come across a God that leaves us scratching our heads, and a God who doesn't always do what we expect like a God like him to do. A God whose ways are higher than our ways, and a God whose thoughts are higher than our thoughts, and a God who does things that sometimes make me wonder, God, what are you really up to? Because we come across this God in the Garden of Eden, and I wonder why the Lord put the tree that tests Adam and Eve. And God, if he created everything, where did the snake come from? I struggle with the Lord finding Jacob in the wilderness, and for no reason and no motive, breaking Jacob's hip. And now he has to live for the rest of his life. I agonize with this God in the book of Job, and I wonder why the Lord would subject Job with everything that he had to go through. And what looks like nothing less than a bet with Satan. What God says to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" And y'all, there are a lot of the things that I want the Lord to do on my behalf. But one of the things that I pray that God never does is to ask Satan, "Has he ever considered me for anything?" No, devil, I just want you to leave me alone. I struggle with a God who Paul talks about, who gives him a thorn in his flesh. And when Paul prays that the Lord operate on him to remove the thorn, the only answer that the Lord gives Paul is that my grace is sufficient. And there's a place in the Bible where me and the Lord don't see eye to eye. And one of those places that bother me the most, as a servant, as a leader of God's people, is what happens right here in Numbers chapter 12. Because when we get to chapter 12, Moses has been leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. And they're wandering place for where they are for 40 years. they circumscribed a mountain in the desert. And it's all because of the Lord finds out that what was ready for them, that they weren't ready for. So God puts the children of Israel in a 40-year timeout for them to get themselves together. And while they're making this wandering wilderness journey, verse 1 tells us that they came into the wilderness of Zin. And it's there in the wilderness of Zin that Miriam dies. And all of us should remember Miriam, because when baby Moses was put in the basket of the Nile River, it was Mary who was there watching over him. When Pharaoh's daughter needed to be nursed and breastfed, it was Miriam who recommended Moses' mother. Miriam was there when Moses was called. And Mary was there just as much as Aaron, because all of us need a sister as much as we need a brother. And everything that Moses has been through, he could rely on Miriam to be there. And the Bible says at the end of verse 1 that Miriam died there and was buried there. So now I want us to think about the grief that Moses was going through because his sister has died. And why he's grieving and why he's hurt. Verse 2 tells us that these Israelites and these people of God who he's been leading, why he's heartbroken and why he's sad, and why he's planning a funeral and writing the obituary. The Bible tells us that they formed a committee. They put together a petition. They put together a group message on Facebook. And they come to Moses in the middle of his grief. And verse 3 says that they quarreled with him. So y'all, they complain, they criticize, they whine, and they say, Moses, why did you leave us all the way out here, where it ain't no water to drink, because we had it better than Egypt, and we told you to leave us alone. But no, Moses, you hear you come talking about let my people go. And we trusted you and we followed you. And now we out here about to die in the wilderness. And by now, y'all, Moses is sick and tired of these folks. Because if you go back to Exodus chapter 32, you'll find out that these some of the most stiff-necked and the most bitter and the most stubborn and the most argumentative people. And these are some of the most complaining people that you ever had to deal with in your life. And nothing is ever good for them. The sun is too hot. The night is too cold. The water ain't sweet enough. And they complain about everything. And have you ever known somebody who complained about everything? The speakers are too loud. The sermon is too short. The coffee ain't dark enough. The back to school baskets ain't big enough. And they complain about everything. And y'all, Moses has had enough. And verse 6 tells us that Moses and Aaron went away from the assembly to the entrance of the tent of meeting because they need some alone time with God. So Moses and Aaron go to see God, and they fall down on their faces. And the Bible says, and the glory of God appeared to them. So the Lord comes down, and Moses tells them what's really going on, because these folk want some water, and they are getting on my nerves. And the Lord spoke to Moses in verse 7, and he tells Moses to relax, because I got this. Take the staff, assemble the congregation, and command the rock before their eyes to yield this water. Now we need to make sure that we get this, because the Lord tells Moses to go talk to a rock, and the rock will give you his water. Now we just missed two crazy things right now. Because number one, you don't talk to a rock because rocks don't talk back. And y'all, on top of that, the Lord says when you talk to the rock, that the rock will give you his water. And we just missed our second crazy thing because rocks don't have water. But y'all, sometimes the Lord calls us to do what seems crazy to somebody else so that you can yield and produce what nobody else has seen before. So go talk to the rock, Moses. So Moses goes outside in verses 9 and 10. And y'all, he's still mad. And he says in verse 10, listen, you rebels. And y'all, I just believe that that's the Bible's way of covering up what Moses really said. So listen here, you rebels. Because shall we bring water for you out of this rock? Now verses 7 and 8 tells us that the Lord spoke to Moses and told him to take the staff, assemble the congregation, and command the rock before their eyes to yield his water. But in verse 11, it tells us that Moses lifted up his hand and struck the rock twice with his staff. Water came down abundantly, and the congregation and their livestock drank. So the Lord told Moses to command the rock, but Moses decided to strike the rock twice with his staff. But y'all, watch how good God is. Because Moses was supposed to talk to the rock. But he was disobedient and he struck the rock. But water still came out. Somebody just missed a shout. Because even when we're not faithful to what God has called us to do, God is so faithful when he fulfills his promise. Even when we're disobedient and we don't do what he's called us to do. And somebody here ought to be able to say amen this morning. Because you know that God has done some things in your life that shouldn't have happened. But God is faithful. And between verses 10 and 11, it seems like everything is good. But God shows up in verse 12. And he says, Moses, let me holler at you and Aaron for a minute. And he tells him, because you did not trust me to show my holiness before the eyes of the Israelites. Therefore, you should not bring this assembly into the land that I've given them. Now, here's what got tough for me, y'all. Because the Lord keeps Moses and Aaron from going into the promised land. Because Moses hit a rock. Because, y'all, that just don't seem right to me. Because if anybody should get a pass, it ought to be Moses. Because look at everything that Moses has done for God. Because Moses put his life on the line for God. Moses exposed his family for God. Moses led these stiff-necked folks in the wilderness. And these people were so bad that even God wanted to kill them. So how is God going to get mad at Moses for being mad at some people that he wanted to kill? Because God, you know these rebels. So why would the Lord keep Moses and Aaron for going into the promised land that he told Moses that he was going to lead his people to? And y'all, that doesn't seem fair or just to me. Because please don't tell me that Moses and Aaron don't get in because they got anger. Because if anger keeps God from giving us what he promises, all of us are in trouble. Please don't tell me that Moses didn't get in because church folk got on his nerves. Because if church folk get on your nerves, make the Lord upset, all of us are going to be in trouble. Because how could God keep his chosen one? And what did Moses do that would keep him of what God had promised him? And y'all, I've been struggling with this all week. Until the Lord showed me that it wasn't about Moses being angry. It wasn't about church folk getting on his nerves. But I want y'all to remember what happened. Because the people complained, and Moses is mad, and Moses goes off. Then in verse 6, Moses and Aaron went away to the assembly to the entrance of the tent of the meeting. The glory of the Lord appeared to them, and Moses leaves, and he's still mad. Two of y'all almost caught that. So Moses is angry. He goes to the tent of meeting. The glory of the Lord shows up, and he leaves mad. Y'all almost got it. So he's mad when he comes into the house of God. The glory of God shows up, and he leaves the house of the Lord as mad at the benediction as he was before the call to worship. So y'all, part of the Lord's issue with Moses is the same issue that he has with you. Because how can you experience God's glory and leave the same way after his glory that you were before you came in? So how can you come to church mad and still leave mad? How can you come to church mean and still leave mean? How can you come with a bad attitude, be in the Lord's presence, but leave with a bad attitude? Because for all of that, you should have stayed at home. Because how can we experience the glory of God and not be transformed, and not be changed, and not have anything happen to us? And y'all, it's a shame and an embarrassment. For the Lord is showing his glory everywhere. And the only hymn that we know is I Should Not Be Moved. Because I ain't gonna think amen. I ain't gonna say amen. I ain't gonna stand up. I ain't telling my neighbor nothing. And my neighbor never not tell me nothing. I don't care what the preacher says. I don't care what the praise team is saying. Because I'm just gonna sit here and be mad. And then the glory of the Lord shows up, and you still leave here mad. But y'all, when we're in the Lord's presence, and we enter into his glory, and we know the authority in this place, we ought to open up our hearts and expect that God is going to change some things. Because when we truly come to worship God, he'll change your mind. He'll change your heart. He'll change your attitude. He'll change your outlook. Because God will change you in his presence. And y'all, ain't nothing worse than dealing with church folk on Monday who are the same way that they were on Sunday. So now I want to ask y'all to do me a favor. And I don't mean to offend nobody this morning, but if y'all are going to come to church every Sunday and you still going to have a bad attitude, still going to be mean and nasty and unfriendly to everybody, still going to be ugly and sour and unpleasant, I need y'all to do me a favor. Don't tell nobody that you're a member of Progressive. As a matter of fact, don't even tell them that you watch us online, that you listen on the radio. Just go on there and tell them that you go to Primitive Baptist Church. And don't tell them that you come over here. Because the expectation is, when you dwell in this place, and you worship this God, and you hear this word, and you give God this praise, that your life ought to be changed. There should be something about us that should let people know that we've been around the Lord. Because we can't be around God and not take in some of this. You can't hear about this God every Sunday and still walk around in doubt. You can't listen to Miss Iris sing every Sunday and never think amen. But something about being in the glory of God should change us. Now, y'all, a couple of years ago, I had to go to Tennessee to my classmate's installation. But he was busy and he couldn't pick me up from the hotel. So he sent one of his homeboys to take me to the restaurant that we were going to be eating at. So I got in the car with his homeboy. And y'all, it was already clear that he smoked. Now, normally cigarette smoke doesn't bother me, but there's something different about that air in Tennessee and the air in North Carolina. Now, y'all know that I'm pretty laid back, and this ain't even my car. But we're driving to the restaurant, and he lights up a Black and Mild on the way. So I'm trying to give him some cigarettes, and I roll down the window. And by this time, I'm sneezing and I'm coughing, and he keeps on smoking. So when we get to the restaurant, my classmate is there. And y'all, this is before COVID. So we dab each other up and give each other a brotherhood. Then he pushed me back. And he said, Fuller, when did you start smoking Black and Mild? And I said, Rebel, you know I don't smoke blacks, but I've been locked up in this car with your homeboy. And because he smokes, and I've been close to him, what he does now is all over me. So now what you smelled on me is because I've been close to him. So can you really get close to God and worship on Sunday morning? There ought to be some things about you that lets your neighbor know, and lets your cousin know, and lets your mama know that you've been in the presence of God. So now I need y'all to do me another favor and pull your mask down for about 15 seconds and just slip on your neighbor and tell them I'm trying to smell some God on you. I'm trying to smell some Jesus on you. So y'all, maybe the Lord is disappointed, but we have the nerve to come to worship, but we don't allow our worship to change us. But there's some things that we ought to leave in worship. So Moses comes in, the glory of the Lord shows up, and he leaves man, and he hits the rock. So now I want us to see what the second problem is. Because when Moses tells the Lord that the people are complaining, the Lord doesn't get mad. Now there are other times in the Bible when the Lord gets mad at the Israelites. And the Lord told Moses to move out of the way, because I'm about to kill all of them. And Moses asked the Lord, Lord, please don't do that. Because if you do that, then the Egyptians are going to hear about it. And they're going to say, see, we knew about y'all, God. So we've seen the Lord mad with the Israelites before. But the Lord doesn't get mad right here. But watch what happens in verse 7. Is that the Lord tells Moses, don't worry about this, because I got this. So take your staff, assemble the congregation, and command the rock before their eyes to yield this water. So there's no, I'm going to curse them. There's no, I'm going to kill them. But take the staff, assemble the people, talk to the rock, and get out of the way, and let me do what I do. Now watch the text, y'all, because the Lord wasn't angry, but Moses is still angry. So could it be that the issue is that the Israelites can't go to the Lord for themselves? So the only way that they know what the Lord has to say is through Moses. So the Lord isn't angry, but Moses comes out angry. So when the people see that Moses is mad, they believe that God is mad. Because Moses failed to witness to the people what God has already said to him. So part of the reason that we miss out on what God has promised us is when we fail to witness to who he is for the people who don't know him for themselves. Because there are people that we meet every day who don't know God, who haven't surrendered their lives to Jesus, who have never opened a Bible, who have never stepped foot in the church. And the Lord says that our lives are supposed to be a witness of what we hear in here on Sunday, so that the people out there would know who God is. And what a shame for us to live our lives in a way that people don't know God. So we live our lives condemning people to hell, and the Lord is saying that's not a reflection of me. We live our lives judging what somebody else does, and the Lord is saying, you got the nerve with all the mercy that I've given you. We live our lives telling somebody else what God doesn't love. And God is saying that as messed up as you are, that I still love your righteous self. And what God is telling Moses and us is what he expects in our lives is to be a witness for the word of God, even with a man in anger, so that people who don't know God can see the God in us. And maybe, y'all, the Lord is holding back his promises for us when our witness doesn't match his word, when our lives don't represent his love, when our mercy to everybody else doesn't reflect his mercy to us. Because how can we want God to put somebody else in hell when we were on our way to hell before he saved us? With all the love that God has poured into me, the only thing I should witness is the love of God. Because Moses heard God say, I got it. But he came out showing that the Lord is mad at y'all. And y'all, it made me wonder, at what point did Moses feel like that he had to add something to what God had already said? At what point do we need to flavor what the Lord has already said with our commentary? Because some stuff is so good that you don't have to add anything to it. Because if the pork chop is fried right, you don't really need any hot sauce. If them collard greens are cooked the right way, you don't really need no vinegar on it. Because there's some stuff that is so good that it doesn't need to be manipulated. So at what point do we need to change what God has already said? Because everything that God says is already good by itself. Because for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Y'all, that's good all by itself. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Y'all, that's good all by itself. And we know that all things work together for them that love God, to him who are called according to his purpose. Y'all, that don't need nothing else. So Moses came into God's presence, and he wasn't changed. Moses left angry, and the people thought that God was angry at them. But y'all, watch this last one and the worst one that keeps us from getting what God has promised us. Because watch what happens in verse 12. Because the Lord says, this is why I can't give you what I promised you. Because you didn't trust in me to show my holiness before the eyes of the Israelites. Now, y'all, that word holiness, it means hallowed or respected. So, Moses, you didn't hallow me or you didn't respect me. Now, hopefully, y'all heard that word hallowed before. Our Father, which is hard in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now, if you don't know that, just act like you do. And that word hallowed means to separate. So, Moses, you can't go to the promised land because you didn't separate God. Because you didn't get out of the way so that the people could see God. Because watch what happens in verse 10. Because Moses comes out and he says to the people, listen, you rebels, shall we bring water for you out of this rock? How long do we have to get y'all some water out of this rock? Y'all ain't getting it. So how long do we have to get water out of this rock? And y'all, this ain't anybody. But I just believe that when Moses said we, that God looked at him between verses 10 and 11, and God said, who is we? Because we ain't making water come out of this rock. Because when water comes out of this rock, we ain't got nothing to do with it. Because if water comes out of this rock, it's only because there's a God in heaven who's able to make ways out of nowhere, who's able to take you from dry places, who's able to open doors that nobody can shut. And how dare we see what God has done in our lives, and we say we. And y'all, there comes a moment when things happen in our lives and we don't have anything to do with it. And we need to get out of the way and allow people to know that it's not my hand. It's not my words. It's not my mind. But it's only because of God that I serve, who's able to make ways out of no way. And y'all, I just believe this morning that God is holding up some of our promises because we had some water come out of some rocks. We had some miracles happen in our lives. We had some ways made that we really can't account for because somebody's working a job this morning that your resume didn't qualify you for. Somebody is living in a house this morning that your credit score didn't get by itself. Somebody has a ring on your finger and you know you're just as ratchet can be. But the Lord has been so good to you. And you come to church every Sunday and you sit there like you made it by yourself. You sit there like we had something to do with it. You sit there like you made a way. You climbed the ladder. You earned that degree. But the Lord is looking for a few folk that every now and again on a Sunday morning, that when you look at the blessings that God has given you, that there's no shame and no hesitation to lift up my hand and say, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, is anybody here that's morning who's not ashamed to hallow the Lord. Is anybody here this morning who's not ashamed to praise the Lord? Anybody here this morning who's not afraid to bless the Lord? But praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give God the glory. Great things he has done. God bless you.